we're going into the fractals. We've sort of hinted at what fractals are. We've talked about or seen this sort of self-similar structure for things like the logistic map and also the Lorentz system. So it seems to be there when we are describing these dynamical systems, but fractals seem to be more general. They usually have some degree of self-similarity, but not always. Things like coastlines or blood vessel networks or clouds or broccoli, all of these things seem to, if you zoom in, you'll see kind of similar things, but on a smaller scale. The key thing about fractals, it's in their name, is that they have a fractional dimension. They have a dimension that's not an integer, which is a weird idea. So we'll eventually connect up this idea of fractals with the strange attractors and things that we're learning about with chaos. But I want to give you a first view of a fractal set. And the simplest one is this thing called the Cantor set, fractals. This is chapter 11 of Strogatz, motivated by a few kind of example fractals, the idea of this, of different ways of measuring the dimension. And they're useful in that they also reduce to the usual dimension when we think of a curve as one-dimensional, a surface as two-dimensional, things in 3D or three-dimensional. But then it also captures some unique properties of these things that have been only appreciated in the last few decades. The Cantor set, there's a relationship with a chaotic system. First, okay, what's a Cantor set? What are we talking about? We've got the interval from 0 to 1, and then we remove the middle third. And what do we get? We've got the middle third removed, and we're keeping the endpoint. So if we're, think of it, this is going to happen in stages. The first stage, say, we'll call this S0. At the next stage, we remove the middle third, keep everything else. So then we've got from 0 to 1/3 and 2/3 to 1. And then repeat that process again. So at S2, for each of the new segments, we remove the middle third. So that means we go from 0 to something. And hopefully you see where this is going, right? We keep removing a middle third over and over again. Just keep on going. Eventually, what you'll get, if you were to follow this down to what we might call S infinity, you're going to have a set of points. So this is also called C, the Cantor set. And my best rendition of it would be a bunch of little points. But it's a lot of points. And there's some properties of this set. Cantor did this in the 1800s, I think around the same time as Poincaré was doing his work. But this was not related to dynamical systems. I don't know what Cantor's goal was, but it was not related to any analysis of chaos or anything. He had other things in mind. But this does have some interesting properties. One thing is it has a total length of 0. And how do we know that? Well, let's look at the length of the first iterate of this process. If I write it this way, that has length 1. The next one, that's 2 segments, each of length 1/3. So it's 2/3. And then what is S2? We do this again. So we've got 2/3 of 2/3. Then you could see maybe where this is going. Sn, the length of the nth iterate in this process, is 2/3 to the n. And since that's less than 1, this goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. It has no length. We might say it has measure 0. Another kind of interesting thing about it, so that's just property 1, property 2. And the book has a discussion about this distinction between a countable and an uncountable set of points. Countable set is in 1-to-1 correspondence with the integers. Uncountable mean it's in 1-to-1 correspondence with the real numbers. You could show that the Cantor set has an uncountable number of points. It has a 1-to-1 correspondence with the real numbers. And you might look at how the book does that. It basically uses this base 3 approach to describe each of the segments. In base 3, there's just 0, 1, and 2. And you can show that each of the points will have an expansion in terms of numbers that only have zeros and twos, but not ones. But it ends up being in one-to-one correspondence with the real numbers. It's self-similar. I mean, you can see it. It contains arbitrarily small copies of itself. So by self-similar, I mean it contains arbitrarily small copies of itself. And maybe you can just see it. Start it with the unit interval and then remove the one-third. But now at this stage, it's almost like we've got an interval and then we remove one-third. So we've got this and the same thing all the way down. We've got an interval, remove one-third. So if you want to, you could think of it as you take S1, shrink it by a factor of 3, and you're left with the left half of S2 and also the right half. So it's almost like there's two copies. And this continues all the way to S infinity. The left half of S infinity is just a shrunken version of S infinity. So that means S infinity contains within it two copies of S infinity. And then, you know, your mind should blow, like, whoa. Right. So we might say, in fact, S infinity is two copies of S infinity, each shrunk by a factor of 3. That's weird. Now, this is a collection of points, and we could talk about what its dimension is. So what do we, let's get into this thing. Dimension of self-similar fractals. And that's not redundant. You don't need to have self-similarity to be a fractal, but the common examples we speak of do. But we'll get to some that do not. So the Cantor set, it's think of it as this set of points. It's a disconnected set of points. There's no intervals in there. It's all just points. But it kind of leads to this question that motivated the idea of fractals. What is the dimension of a set of points? And for the familiar geometric objects, the answer is kind of clear, right? Lines and smooth curves are one-dimensional. Planes and smooth surfaces are two-dimensional. Solids are three-dimensional and so on. So if we were forced to give a definition, we could say that the dimension is the minimum number of coordinates needed to describe every point in the set. So this is our usual idea of dimension. So what do I mean by this? Think of a curve. Here's a curve in 2D on the screen. We would say, even though it's in this sort of 2D screen space, we would use a single number, maybe the arc length, to describe like this point. You would kind of go along and say, okay, if I calculate that arc length from this end over here, I could give each point along this curve a unique value, and that specifies the point. And I just need one number. So we would say a curve is one-dimensional, right? And then the same thing for some kind of curved surface in 3D, or embedded in any dimension, actually. It's almost like you'd put down some coordinate lines, and then you'd say, well, if I specify those two numbers, then I've specified this, each point. I can specify every point in this set. But when we try to apply this to fractals, we run into paradoxes. So one good example is this thing called the von Koch curve, or just the Koch curve. Consider the von Koch curve. It's a cool construction, probably easier to understand than the Cantor set. But you start with a line. You can think of it as the unit interval if you want. So we'll call that S0. So we start with a line segment. And then to generate the next step, S1, we delete the middle third of S0 and replace it with two sides of an equilateral triangle. So we've got this. And then in the middle third, we make an equilateral triangle. So each of these four segments is the same size. Then we do this again. So for each segment, we take the middle third, make an equilateral triangle. And it's kind of hard to do, but not impossible. You get it? And then if you keep doing this, okay, so there's S3 and S4, right? You carry this out to infinity, and this would be S infinity, or you could call it the Koch curve, okay. And it's got some, you know, interesting properties. What is the dimension of this curve, the final curve that you get at the end? Well, we're calling it a curve. So you might think, since it's a curve, it's one dimensional. But the trouble is it has infinite arc length. And to see this, just you could observe how the length is growing at each of these iterates. S naught has length L naught. Then the length of S1 has length L1, which is 4/3 L naught. And so hopefully you can see where this is going, right? At each step of the construction. So Sn has length Ln 4/3 raised to the n L naught. S infinity has length L infinity, which is the limit as n goes to infinity Ln. But right, 4/3 is greater than 1. So this is going to, you know, infinity. And in fact, it's not just that. You take any two points on this curve, and they're separated by an infinite arc length. How can we see that? If we were to pick a little spot and zoom in, right? So pick this spot. We're looking at the bottom. Pick that red box, zoom in. Right, because of the self-similarity, it looks the same. Okay, zoom in, zoom in. Between any two points on the, you know, S infinity, the Koch curve, it's infinite. So how can you give a unique arc length location for any of the points? So that's a paradox. So it suggests that K is something more than one dimensional, but it doesn't seem to fill an area. So it's not quite two dimensional. So it seems like the dimension should be between one and two. So then the challenge is trying to figure out, okay, how exactly do we do that? So we want to give a notion of dimension that can cope with fractals. So it's not going to be this. Dimension is not going to be the minimum number of coordinates needed to describe every point in the set. So this doesn't work for fractals. In some sense, that's what will define a fractal. So you can't do that. This is the similarity dimension. The Koch curve and the Cantor set, they're both self-similar. So they're made of scaled down copies of themselves, all the way down to arbitrarily small scales. So the dimension of these fractals could be defined by extending an observation about familiar sets like line segments, squares, and cubes. So let's just show a square. Here's a square. And if we were to break the square up into four copies, if we have m equals the number of copies, in this case, we break it into four copies. Well, each of those boxes was scaled by a factor of two. So in this case, m equals four, r equals two. And you could think of it as one way or the other. You either impose the scale factor or the number of copies. There's going to be a relationship between them. What if we were to take the square and look at scaled down versions by a factor of three? Right, it's one of those squares. Well, to fill the original one, we're going to need nine copies. So for a scale factor of three, we need m equals nine. The scale factor is just scaling by that factor in each direction. So if you take a look at this, what's going on? If the square is scaled by a factor of r, then we need r squared of the smaller squares to equal the original. The observation here is that when you have m copies, m equals r squared. So the focus here is on that exponent. And the exponent here just seems to be representing that the square is in 2D, right? We're thinking of the actual square, not just this boundary, okay, the square. If we did this in 3D for a cube, right? If you take a cube wow, I have a cube. If you take this cube and scale down all the dimensions by a factor of two, well, there's going to be, you'll need 8 copies of the cube. So for a cube, if we scale down by a factor of r, we'll need m equals r to the third power little copies. So this suggests that we can define for any object, especially these self-similar fractals, the self-similarity dimension d as that exponent. We'll define it by m equals r raised to the d. And we won't impose that it has to be an integer. We'll just sort of see what happens, what comes out of it. So if you take the natural log of both sides, you get d equals the natural log of m divided by the natural log of r. And then let's try this for the Cantor set. For the Cantor set, let's go back up here to it. When we scale down, we're always scaling down by a factor of 3. When we scale down by a factor of 3, we get 2 copies. So by the construction, we already know what m and r. When we scale down by a factor of r equals 3, we get m equals 2 copies of the original, right? For s infinity, we scale down by a factor of r, and we had m copies, we had 2. So this suggests that the dimension d for the Cantor set is natural log of 2 divided by natural log of 3, which is about 0.63, something between 0 and 1, right? It's not quite a point, which would have dimension 0. It's not quite a line. So it has some dimension in between. It's not even quite a fraction. It's not a rational number. I think it's irrational. So that makes fractal somewhat of a confusing phrase. Maybe originally they thought it would be like 5/3 or something. What about the Koch curve? If you noticed from the construction, we scale down by a factor of 3 and we get 4 copies. Hopefully you can see that. So the curve is made of 4 equal pieces, each of which is similar to the original curve, but scaled down by a factor of 3. And again, it's there in the construction of it. So this gives us m equals 4, r equals 3. The dimension here should be ln 4 divided by ln 3, which ends up being 1.26, roughly. So again, somewhere in between 1 and 2, like we expected. Not quite a curve, not quite an area. There's other ways to measure dimension other than these that lend themselves to computations for any kind of thing. So one example that has been brought up is, what is the length of the coastline of Britain?